Father, do we know the nature of the protein or immune response to the virus?
So we suggest that it might be capsular polysaccharide, and in fact, you know, there's a number of adhesives of campylobacter, so we haven't tested them as such yet. But to date, nobody's come up with an adhesive, especially.
Michelle did her PhD in Galway, postdoc in the US, and she's a recipient of the Society of Chemistry and Analytical Award in 2018. Main area of research is host microbe interactions, immune response, spectrum polysaccharides, and biofilms, and development of biological analytical methods and platforms for analysis. Thank you, Michelle.
So thanks very much for the invitation to speak to Paul and Bruce Senta. So it is a privilege to be able to talk here today in this event. As Olga mentioned, I did do my PhD here under mentorship of Professor Angela Savage, who's in the audience there, and he's going to be chairing the judging panel later. And with Angela, I trained in analytical carbohydrate chemistry, mainly in bacterial polysaccharides. And I've stayed in that type of an area ever since, and which I suppose is obvious in the domain of biology. So I've stuck with analytical approaches to carbohydrates and expanded from kind of traditional methods of analytics into platform building and looking at how to measure and look at interactions in a more high throughput manner. So that's what I'm just going to cover today, a couple of short stories. So we've heard very nicely this afternoon from Mary and Marguerite about the gut microbiome and how our commensals live quite happily in there, in the mucus layer, which is different as we travel through the gastrointestinal tract. So the mucus layer varies as we go through the gastrointestinal tract, and its composition varies, and the glycosylation varies. So it's mainly composed of mucins, as we've heard about from Marguerite. And so we have the protein backbone, it's very heavily glycosylated, up to 90% glycosylation. And mainly we have oleate glycosylation, we have it with N8 at the terminal. So as I said, the commensals, our commensal microbiota live in the mucus layer throughout the gastrointestinal tract. And the pathogens have to penetrate this to get through the mucus layer to reach the epithelium to be actually able to escape. So living in the mucus layer, the commensals, they have to have adhesins to grab onto the mucins, which are the living component of the mucus layer. And very often these adhesins are lectins, so they bind to the carbohydrates of the actual mucins. And these adhesins may be structure specific, in fact, they often are, because the structures of the mucins vary as one goes through the gastrointestinal tract. So they vary in glycosylation depending on the location, depending on the colonizers of that location, depending on the health of the individual, what they've been eating, and the kind of crosstalk between the commensals and the host. So they have to anchor themselves on here, and they also produce glycosylases that cleave to know what adhesions are there and what they want to. Well, for, in the case of commensals, we might want to understand better where they're located in the gastrointestinal tract. If we want to use them therapeutically, perhaps we could target them better to that location. And as I believe that we heard, even though I'm sorry that I wasn't here this morning because I was teaching, but for pathogens, one might produce mimics then for their ligands, that they bind to. So one might produce mimics to compete against pathogen binding to these ligands, and so it can pick them off, leave them in the mucosphere, and let them be stored off. So that they don't have an opportunity then to actually go through the immune mucosphere and actually bind to the cell surface. So in terms then of looking at mucus or mucin interactions, this is pretty interesting to a lot of people, and pretty important in terms of health and disease. So for looking at mucins, examining mucin interactions in the first place, first we have to produce mucin from the mucus. So typically what happens is get the mucus from the tissue and scrape off the mucus and go through many, many steps to purify the mucus and desalt it. And this can take 4 weeks, maybe more. As Marie, Dr. Lemire there in the audience knows very well, who has spent weeks and weeks purifying mucus from animal samples. So then eventually, what you do is you look at microtiger plate binding assays, where you culture your plate with these purified mucins, which you get in quite low yield, milligram quantities, or slot plots, and then you incubate the bacteria into your vines and try and change conditions, trying to keep binding off. But of course, these methods stay kind of each sample. So you don't get to do very many experiments before suddenly your purified material, if you got from your biological source, is all gone. So as Marguerite mentioned, we have built a series of microarray platforms in the lab. And I'm sure everybody's quite familiar from Rob's talk earlier on, and the kind of layout, but this is a cartoon. We have our kind of glass-like surface or whatever surface, and you can array, mobilize, conjugate anything you want, really. Lectins, which would be carbohydrate binding proteins. So if you want to look for glycosylation of a, for example, glycoprotein protein here, and you can label it fluorescently, on your array, the lectins will interact with the carbohydrate portion, and then by means of detecting the fluorescence, you'll be able to figure out what kind of glycosylation is there. And in terms then of looking for adhesins, we put neoglycan conjugates, so artificial glycoproteins basically, and we have a BSA or HSA backbone on which is conjugated certain structures. So they're multimerically displayed, and we conjugate them onto the surface. So if your protein or whatever sample you have is able to bind to carbohydrates, it should bind to the carbohydrate then that it's specific to. So we extended that into mucins, and as Margaret mentioned, we went with this approach because we know that. Mucins, of course, they're very heavily glycosylated, but there are some free amino groups available, typically at the termini, and they're not very heavily glycosylated at the termini, so these are available for contribution to the surface. And in fact, this would have been more advantageous because it would present the glycosylation as would be presented by the molecule itself, so the density and presentation would be similar. So we're getting to present the glycosylation as it is obviously naturally on mucins, but in a kind of high throughput format. So we're getting to do a lot more interrogations or experiments with the same tiny quantity of sample, but we're just using it, I guess, in a better way. So our current version has gastrointestinal finds that mucin is from different areas of the gastrointestinal tract of eight species, no humans, and from two human derived gastrointestinal tract cell lines. So all the mucins on our arrays are from Marguerite and colleagues from UCT. So in terms of incubating whole bacteria, so we can incubate not just purified proteins on there, but we can incubate whole bacteria. So we actually stain them fluorescently internally. So of course we can do the titration, how much stain are you going to use for each of your species and each of your strains. Titrate them on microarrays and choose your optimal cell number then for incubations. So this is our typical layout. We have replicate, this is a summary. So we print our whatever we're printing on there, about 56 typically. We print then replicate summaries on the same slide, so we can do titrations, we can co-incubate things in there, see if we're altering binding, and we can compare different strains and different conditions in the same experiment. So of course this is limited to bacteria, you can also do DNA cells, and you can also incubate exosomes. So this is data generated by Marguerite. So then you can use this type of platform to generate data like this. So as Marguerite was mentioning, they included Compilobacter jejuni here in blue and Helicobacter pylori, and we're able to show that, as Marguerite had been talking about, the favoring of binding to mucins from chicken gastrointestinal tract versus the favoring of Helicobacter binding to mucin from human-derived cell lines. So the two short stories then that I'm going to tell you, so we do a lot of collaborative work as well as work that's based on our own lab. So the first short story I'm going to tell you is about a pathogen, and it's based on collaborative work that we did and was published a year or so ago now. And then the second story is about the binding affinity of commensal species doing in our own lab. So the pathogen that I'm going to talk about is adenovirus. And human adenovirus causes disease in airways, eyes, liver, tonsils, or adenoids, of course, where they came from. So an infection is often asymptomatic and harmless, but in immunocompromised individuals, it can be quite big. How these viruses bind is via these fibers. So they have 12 of these fibers at each vertex here, and they have this little non-domainer or limited fiber here, and each of these is a lectin or an adhesive. And the adenovirus uses these to bind to a host cell molecule. So for most of the human adenoviruses, the ligand that or the target of the human adenovirus is known. So this neuroreceptor, so six, pepper, and so on. Human adenoviruses are popularly used as viral vectors for gene and cancer therapy or for vaccination strategies, as a therapy, being investigated for that. And of course, one of the advantages is that you can target them to certain cells or certain tissue types because of these very nice fibers here. So, to expand the repertoire, it would be nice to be able to use animal adenoviruses also, where most of the ligands or targets for animal adenoviruses aren't known. So we were contacted by our collaborator, Professor Mark van Raj of SOSIC in Madrid, because he was interested in finding the target for the terminal fiber here of a mouse adenovirus. So mouse adenovirus 2, there's also a mouse adenovirus 1, and its number of St. James as the human adenovirus. It's isolated from the disease of house mouse. It causes disease in mice, but not in rats, confusingly. And it affects in vitro, it infects gastrointestinal cells in mice, but not monkey or human cell lines. So what Mark and his team did was they took the sequence, the terminal sequence of this fiber, and they recombinantly expressed it in E. coli and they crystallized it. So, of course, I can't, I'm not a crystallographer, but they showed the assembly of the primer, and they evaluated by superposition approach whether this mouse adenovirus might bind to prostaglandin adenovirus receptor, so typical receptors for humans, for human adenovirus, and CD46, and they concluded that it didn't really look like it didn't really fit. But they also noticed that this structure was similar to canine adenovirus, which is one of the few animal viruses where the ligand is known. And the ligand for that is a carbohydrate. So at that point then they contacted us. So they ended up sending us two proteins, one slightly longer than the other, and we ended up profiling them on our carbohydrate calculators. So we saw that this is the longer one, bound very, very well to the glutamate nuclide conjugate, so that's just N-cyclobutoxamine. Multimeter presented on DSA backbone, regulate. So it was inhibitable, the binding was inhibitable in the presence of 100 millimolar of glutamate, and we had to detect the binding with a secondary antibody because these proteins were very, very unstable, so we could label them directly, but they didn't survive it. So we had to deal with an antibody that was directly labeled, and of course that didn't interact by itself. And we saw some binding that was inhibitable also to ovo-nucleid. And ovo-nucleid has a lot of these ending structures with terminal N-acetyl glucosamine residues all the way to them also. It's the same for the slightly shorter sequence that we had. And then having this information that the target of this fiber fragment, the end terminus, was N-acetyl glucosamine. And in another collaboration, Mark was working with him in Barbero, in also and they determined by Susan Moore that the most likely binding interactions were here at C3 and C4 of the VMAC and the magnitude also of that. And when they looked at quite a while here, it was definitely the non-reducing end, not the reducing end of the N-acetyl glucosamine ligand. So the N-acetyl glucosamine has to be the terminal structure. By isothermal calorimetry, they were able to determine that each binding event was a 1-to-1 binding, and so presumably, when the protein was assembled into the trimer, the binding was multivalent. And because the affinity is quite low, or the association constant by unit is quite low, the affinity presumably would increase with the multivalent binding when the fibers assembled, and of course, the multiple versions as well. So we were happy with ourselves, and we put the paper together. And the reviewers came back, and they said, "That's very nice work. Thanks very much. But so what? we like the work, but what does it mean?" So of course we were a little bit taken aback. This is really behind the data here. What's the biological purpose they wanted to know? So of course we were involved in protests about, well, you know, that's not the scope of the paper and so on, but the editor wasn't having it and they said no thanks. So we had a little think, what can we do? And then we thought, okay, well, a virus is supposed to, or does infect the gastrointestinal tract at once. So obviously it's able to get into the cells, able to bypass the mucus there very easily. So it probably doesn't interact with the mucin, so it doesn't interact very well. But it doesn't, or it isn't able to infect rats. So it should bind very well to the mucin of rats. So we thought, okay, well, look, we'll have a look at the interaction on the mucin microarray, and we'll propose this as biological purpose. And sure enough, these fibers interacted very well with a lot of different mucins from different areas of the gastrointestinal tract, different species, including horse, cow, sheep, and so on, but really not very well to mouse. But they interacted, or they bound very intensely to rat mucins. So then our proposal, I guess, based on our data, is that we still haven't, of course, identified the actual structure on the cell surface that the adenovirus binds to. But what we can propose biologically is that the mouse mucin doesn't have this structure, or doesn't have a lot of the structure in its mucus layer, on its mucin. So the mucus layer is unable to impede the progress of the adenovirus through the mucus layer and onto the cells, where it's able to bind and invade. Whereas the rat, the adenovirus binds very well to the mucus layer, so it's obviously impeded by the mucus layer and is able to be passed out, and so it never gets to bind to the cell surface and actually invade. So these platforms are good for hypothesis generation. So just moving on, thank you. To the second story of commensals, and this work was mainly done by a PhD student in the University of Ben West. Rather quickly, our interest in lactobacillus paracasei subspecies paracasei is because it's a well-known probiotic that has some beneficial health effects. It's closely related to Lactobacillus rhamnosus, which is the most studied Lactobacillus, or most studied human probiotic altogether. Its adhesion specificity is unknown, although Lactobacillus johnsoni and rhamnosus are known to produce pili, it's not known whether paracasei produces it. So Ben was able to predict that there were putative pili clusters in Lactobacillus paracasei. Then did a lithium chloride extraction, which is supposed to remove the proteins from the surface of the whole bacteria. But by mass spec analysis, we were only able to identify two adhesions, elongation factor 2 and chaperone and 0EL. Now, it could be that different conditions are required to remove this pilus, or maybe the pilus isn't produced in vitro under these conditions. So then looking at the binding of paracasei, we see that, so paracasei here is in green, it's quite similar to the binding of Lactobacillus johnsoni and rhamnosus, but it does have some differences where it binds more intensely, so the rat and human mucin, bovine spiral colon mucin, and then not binding to some other ones. So, in terms of mucin binding, it's actually Lactobacillus rhamnosus and johnsoni are quite similar, so perhaps they colonize the same area in the gastrointestinal tract, and paracasei is more different from them. Then, what's the structure? Or structures that it binds to, because of course it's a whole bacteria, so it probably has multiple adhesions going on. And comparing the binding of lectins to the same mucins, we see that paracasei is more similar in binding to MAA, or MAA is binding to some of the same things that paracasei binds to. So MAA binds to, has an affinity for 2-3-mixed sialic acid. So profiling then paracasei and johnsoni and rhamnosus on carbohydrate microarrays, we see that yes, They all bind to 3-ASA sialic acid, also 6-ASA sialic acid, also 3-ASA sialic acid in branch, not just termini. But it also binds to glycosylated structures, 2-3-4 linked, as well as non-glycosylated structures. Not every structure. It doesn't tolerate binding to sialylated structures, for example, even when it's sialylated. Only certain structures that are sialylated. But just looking at carbohydrate binding alone, so where these structures are presented individually, not as part of the mixture as is found in the biological milieu. Paracasing is actually quite similar to John Solnay binding, and rhamnosis then is quite different. So paracasing then, where does it localize? Well, it seems to bind to glycosylated structures which are found are more concentrated in the stomach end. But it also seems to bind to sialylated structures, which are more prevalent in the colon and the gastrointestinal tract. And in 2007, there was a paper in non-probiotic mice that said that paracasei, or lactobacillus paracasei, was found throughout the gastrointestinal tract with a greater concentration in the colon. However, this may not be true. Because our data, definitely there was more intense binding for other species, much lower binding for mice than using. And so we suggest maybe mouse is a good model for human probiotics. So quick summary, these platforms are useful for profiling and ascertaining interactions of a lot of different sample types. And they're very effective for looking at altered glycosylation, looking at inhibitors or altered binding under different conditions, looking at adhesion specificity, but also generating hypotheses for further biological studies. So thank you to ADRC, including Phil Cash and you who are here, but also Larry Ben, who carried out the lactobacillus work, Alan, who did the virus work, and Robert, who is on the physical grid. And of course, collaborators in this community are interested today, and for the interest in support for the years. Thank you very much.
Break, and I invite my colleague who doesn't know bounds to introduce the next speaker.